What cut? Okay.
Mark.
Start.
I'm Mark.
I'm Kaz.
Steven.
And we want to do this Smith podcast.
Yep, we're a few Smiths fans. This is actually my son right here.
And he's got the t-shirt to prove it.
Oh, yeah.
That he's a Smiths fan.
Yeah.
I almost wore a t-shirt. I was like,
I did wear a t-shirt.
I'm like, I'm not going to wear a t-shirt. Like, it's like wearing your Smiths t-shirt to a Smiths concert.
No. You know what I wore to a Smiths concert once, though? Cure t-shirt. I did, and you know why I did that? I had nothing else clean. So I was either going topless or wear the Cure t-shirt. So I wore the Cure t-shirt, but yeah, no, anyway.
Oh, wait, what are we...
Why are we doing
this? Oh, well, I was... Johnny Marr just came out with his autobiography, the Set the Boy Free, and I was like, really happy because I got it on Audible and he actually reads it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's actually read by him, and so I started listening to it and it's really good. And then my brother got me for Christmas Morrissey's autobiography. Which is read
like
by
two pages, and it says,
I'm the best.
Yeah.
Everybody else sucks, basically. It was like, so I listened to Set the Boy Free, and I was like, oh, this is really good, because he spends enough time on the Smiths, but then he spends a lot of time on his other projects, it's been,
it's not like he only did the Smiths. Like,
I
feel like with Morrissey, for example, the Smiths is like the main thing he did, and then he has his solo career after the Smiths, and there's like, you can go on forever about his solo career, but I feel like with Johnny Marr, the stuff he did after the Smiths is equally as interesting because there's so much of it, and like he's worked not just like in popular music but also like on films and stuff. He did the score for Inception,
and he also worked on the Colors.
Yeah,
but at the soundtrack for it, actually,
Colors
like on Nightmare Walk and the gangster one. Remember in the
90s? Oh, okay,
the 90s.
That's the one.
Yeah, but actually, you said that. Who was it? Herbie Hancock came in and kind of, or somebody
came in. And destroyed
it. Was it John Hancock or Herbie Hancock? I don't know.
John Hancock.
From Tommy.
Remember?
It
did something. Like, everybody'd be kind of shocked. He'd be like, what the hell is he doing here?
Yeah.
But anyway, so there was that. So I read that or listened to it, and then I listened to the Morrissey one. He didn't even narrate it. Do you watch Walking Dead?
A little bit.
Well, there's the governor.
Yep.
He's the guy that narrates it. And his last name is Morrissey. Yeah. The governor.
Yeah.
But he's got, he's really, he's British and, sounds really good and stuff. But I listened to this one podcast called Are You Talking U2 to Me or something. Anyway, and all they did was go through U2, which U2 is like, sucks, but
yeah,
but they were so funny. I enjoyed it. So I love the podcast, and then I was like, this is awesome. I should do something like that. And
lo and behold, here we are.
I called up Steve.
Yeah, he called me up out of the blue. I haven't talked to this guy in like 30 years, and
whatever.
Last time he talked to me, Mark said, "Hey, give me your lunch money, or else I'm gonna pound your face." And
that's right.
He called me up and he said, "Hey, what do you think about doing a podcast?" And I thought, well, I could definitely do that. That sounds like a lot of fun. And that's when I told him about Kaz. And just some history here. When I first married my wife, when we bought our first house, we had Mark come over. And Mark lived with us, and it was actually really fun because Kaz was a little, toddler. Well, he was what, two?
Probably.
Two, three?
Three, I think he was.
And so,
he could talk.
Some age.
And so Mark and Kaz used to mess around all the time, and Kaz what he liked doing was we had this big living room, and he always used to stand right in front of the TV and start spinning around. He'd be like, look, I'm spinning, and Mark's saying, get out of the way, Cass!
To be fair, it was the only way anybody would watch me.
That's not true. But anyway, he used to do that all the time, and so Mark actually knew Kaz when he was a little kid, and Mark kind of got to see Kaz grow up from a different perspective. And one day, Mark was so happy. I think I was on a call at work because I worked from home, and Mark came up so happy. He came running upstairs. He's like, "Hey, Steve, check this out." I'm like, "Hold on, put my call on hold." And Mark comes in and he's all happy. He's like, "Hey, guess what? I just did it to Kaz. He was watching TV and I stood in front of the TV and I just spun his butt and Kaz got upset."
I know, what a jerk, man. Dude, I got that little toddler, 3-year-old. I showed him. Yeah.
That was so
awesome. I probably had some growing up to do. But so did Kaz. He was being such a kid.
Yeah, he was acting like such a 2-year-old.
He had to be 3 or 4, yeah. I swear, he was talking. I wasn't picking on a 2-year-old, man. Yeah. He was big enough to block the TV. I mean, a 2-year-old's like...
But I mean, also, how big was our TV? Like, this big?
Well, no, it was a big TV. At least for the time.
Yeah, I mean, it was one of those...
It was probably...
It was like a 32-inch.
Yeah.
It was a 32-inch big CRT TV.
So... Steve, you've listened to the Smiths, I mean, for a long time.
Yeah.
Let's talk to the Kaz. How did you get into the Smiths? I mean, did your dad force you into it?
No. I grew up with the Smiths, just always, you know. Everybody loves How Soon Is Now, and that was kind of just what I had as my idea for the Smiths for most of my life. And then when I was, I want to say 15, I went on a trip to California and I just decided, you know what, I'm going to listen to the Smiths. My dad says they're really good, so, you know, why not? And then I listened to them and I'm like, hey, this is pretty good. And then...
What album was it?
I think it was Hatful. I think I was listening to it through dinner. We were having dinner with some extended family. I was just listening to it through headphones, and I don't know whether the conversation was just boring or whether Heaven Knows I'm Miserable Now is really good, but from that moment I was just hooked. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
All right. So, obviously, I guess everybody finds their own way into it. Can't force it on anybody. I mean, but think about that. Like, was there, when you're... Do you listen to any stuff that your parents listen to?
A little bit. I listen to... Like, my dad, he really loves Creedence Clearwater
Revival. Oh, well, okay, they're good.
And the other group person that he likes is Weird Al Yankovic.
Oh, yeah, Weird Al's great.
So, I mean...
I know. Whenever I used to work at Little Caesars with him, he actually... Because I remember the first Weird Al... I bought one of the first albums I bought was Weird Al Yankovic in 3D.
Yeah.
You know, and I what was the song on there that was the big one?
Oh, he had like three of them. I think one of them was it wasn't Eat It.
Eat It was on there.
Was it?
Oh, right, no.
Yeah, no. Eat It was on there.
There's Nature Trail to Hell.
Yep.
the king of Sway. Yeah. Anyway, I was really like there was whatever. I'm sorry, guys. Whatever the main hit was, I was really disappointed. I mean, I loved the song, but the rest of it was kind of like song that I didn't know. You know, like the Police. There's the Ride of the Kaiser. Yeah. Oh, that was the Ride of the Kaiser. Where he's all talking about different brands. Anyway, so I was kind of like I think I just listened to the one over and over again, the main song, whatever it was. And then, but when I was working with Little Caesars, your dad had Dare to Be Stupid.
Yep.
And oh my gosh, that whole album is just so good. Anyway.
Yeah, Mark has actually grown up with our family.
Oh, yeah.
Pretty extensively because my dad used to manage a Little Caesars store. He still does today. But when we were in high school, Mark got a job working for my dad. And so he got indoctrinated with all my dad's crappy stuff.
No, that was good stuff.
Well, Weird Al was good, but Air Supply, yeah. Come on.
I don't remember Air Supply.
Oh, man, he'd always talk about Air Supply, and it was just like...
Well, that's what I'm saying, but, like, there's not, like, a band that your dad loves that you...
Like, what my dad likes, I don't think that I would, you know, just pick up my device and say, hey, I'm going to listen to Weird Al today. It's, you know, if I'm on a shuffle, then it comes on, I'll leave it on, but I won't skip through it. But it's not something that I say, I really feel like I should be listening to CCR today or Air Supply or Weird Al.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's...
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I don't think there's ever... I mean, I'm just trying to think about... I mean, Saturday Night Fever or something. An album I like that my parents liked, but... Yeah, I don't think there's really... Yeah. Anyway, so it's just interesting. But, I mean, I think that just shows how good of a band the Smiths are, and Morrissey and Johnny Marr.
And I mean, a lot definitely... I feel like a lot of it has to do with it coming through my genes and in my DNA. Like, I love the Smiths and Suede, which...
DNA. I don't think music tastes are...
It is. It's
maybe,
actually,
oh, maybe it is.
It's on the 312th chromosome.
All right. So anyways. I really love the Smiths and Suede, which are bands my dad really likes. But also, he likes stuff like Ministry.
Yeah, what's the matter with Ministry?
Well,
this sucks.
No, they don't.
I think it's... But I think it's kind of... The time that we were growing up, so we were into the Smiths, and then there's like these alternative bands, so you know, we'd find different ones because, yeah, I'm sure you're not going to agree on every band. I mean,
yeah.
But I'm sure every band that you like, you know, you probably like some modern stuff that your dad might not
like.
Yeah,
like
Chameleon Circuit, I don't care.
No, I don't even
know
anymore. That's a like parody band that I liked when I was like 12. But,
whoa. Dude, that was when you were 12. You sure it was when you were spinning in front of the TV?
Yeah, no. Everybody makes bad music decisions when they're 12.
I never.
Well, no, we all
bad
we still
music
do.
Decisions ever.
Well, that was one thing that, like, a lot of people are into a variety of stuff. And for me, like, I was just like the Smiths and Morrissey. I mean, because. You know, Johnny Marr, he was off doing stuff with other bands and stuff, so he never was really putting out his own stuff. So it was the Smiths and Morrissey, and I kind of dabble out on different other bands, you know, but not... I mean, that was just my go-to for...
Yeah, well, so when I grew up, my younger life, it was in Nebraska.
Yeah.
And in Nebraska, at that time, you had your choice of, like, three different FM radio stations... and probably 10 AM radio stations. And the ones that weren't giving you the Farm Report were giving you country music or heavy metal. And I couldn't stand heavy metal when I was a kid because it was just noise to me. It didn't sound like music. It just sounded like people beating on things and yelling, and I didn't like that. And so one time we had to go to Lincoln for my youngest brother had some heart issues. And so we'd have to go back to Lincoln to the hospital there to have him get taken care of. And this was probably 86, 87, maybe 86. Because it was after my mom died.
Yeah.
It was after my mom died. And it was, I think I had... it's just hard to remember, but I remember going to Lincoln because of him having to go to the hospital, and they have the university there, so they had the university stations. And on came How Soon Is Now, and I heard that, and I just thought, holy hell, this is awesome music, and I had no clue who it was. So I'm sitting there listening to the radio. And in those days, you didn't have these cool radios that were like in the cars today. It was basically, you had push buttons and you had dials that would change the radio station. And once you turned the car off, there went the radio too. And so we get to the hospital, and the song's just coming to the end, and the DJ is coming on and started to say the name of the band. My dad turns off the car. Okay, we're here. That was the... was the... So I had no clue who they were, and I was looking everywhere to see if I couldn't listen to that. And right around 88, I think it was 88.
When did you guys move out here?
In 90.
Okay. Because I'm trying, I'm like, okay.
Because I think it was at 88 I heard Suedehead, and that's when they said Morrissey. He was also the, you know, they just broke up with the Smiths, and that was... you know, that was Morrissey, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, oh, the Smiths, I have to check them out. And that's when I went to a record store. And again, in Nebraska, you don't have good record stores, so it was tough finding it. When I finally found it, I found, back in those days, it was tapes and records. Mm-hmm. And so I got a tape, and you could listen to it. And so I started listening to it, and I heard the song, and I'm like, oh, I found them, this is it. And then I went to go buy the cassette, and I got it and everything, and the tape melted on the way home.
So, on the way home?
Yeah, it was in the summer, and in Nebraska, it's not as hot as here, but the humidity is just atrocious. And so I made the mistake, because I was a kid and I didn't know any better, and I put the cassette up on the dashboard. So,
oh, that happens there too? Because I know here, man. All
right, yeah. It's just like, to clarify, where is here?
Oh, Arizona.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, here, like, I remember one time I had gotten some basil leaves for my dad, and, you know, and then I went in for an...
Basil leaves.
Yeah. Oh, man, yeah. A little bit of herb. No, it was basil. It was actual basil. And I went in somewhere for an hour, you know, it was the middle of the summer, came out, and they were dried, I mean, just dried out. Like, so, and I've had a lot of, you know, warped... Yeah. CDs, tapes, whatever. You put anything in the windshield here, I didn't know that.
Well, only in the summer. I mean, if you get the right hot day that has high humidity and you go inside or you're traveling a while, that windshield just reflects that sunlight, just starts baking everything inside of it.
So what album was that?
I think I got the... I think that was on...
Would it be on Half Full of Hope? No, or it wasn't. Meet Us Murder?
It was probably the U.S. Meet Us Murder it had to have been.
Yeah,
because it wasn't Half Full.
Yeah, no, because they added in How Soon Is Now on the U.S. version.
Yeah, you got to think about it, because actually, whenever I listen to Meet Us Murder, I always try to skip over it. So yeah. I'm like, this is what. But man, it's such a short album. Then you're just like, whoa, I'm done already.
Yeah.
You know, because you put in that extra 5 minutes. You know, anyway, but. I don't know really when the first time I heard them was, because there wasn't, but I remember, I don't know even know the timeline, because but I remember the first cassettes we walked up to Stinkweeds, which was the record store. Like the alternative record store that finally came.
The best record
store. Yeah, yeah. Kimber and everybody. Yeah. So it was right before I was going into ninth grade, and I bought, or was it eighth or ninth? Anyway, I remember the first, I bought The Queen Is Dead and Louder Than Bombs cassettes. And then I bought this huge poster that I started something I couldn't finish with, that lady with that weird bonnet on.
Yeah.
Poster that I had in my room. Anyway, and I just listened to those to death, you know, and fell in love. So, but I can't. I don't know. So we're not like people that were there at the beginning of the Smiths, you know, or anything. Like some people, you know, like the singles and all that stuff. To me, like, because to Morrissey, they seem like he was always talking about their singles and. They're a singles band, but to me, they're always an album band. You know, there's like these, there's the albums. That's what I listen to.
Yeah, and I could see his point that they were more of a singles group, because if you look at their entire discography, it's basically the self-titled album, and then you have Hat Full of Hollow, which isn't an album. It's a collection of singles that they put out.
Yeah.
And then you have Meet Us Murder, which is their album. And then you have Queen Is Dead, which is an album. And then you have Louder Than Bombs, which is singles. World Won't Listen, singles.
Yeah.
They have all these singles albums, and they only have really three or four actual
albums. Yeah, so you got The Smiths, the debut album.
Yep.
Meet His Murder, that we're talking about like proper albums. Yeah. Meet His Murder,
Queen.
Queen's Dead, and Strange Ways Here We Come. Four albums. Four. But then they have these six, I mean, they were putting out so many singles, and somebody was talking about, they're like, why didn't they just, they should have made albums, but he was obsessed with making singles for some reason. They put such good songs on the singles, you know, so, but anyway, it ended up for the best, because Half Full Hollow, and those, you know, are like nice long albums, and really good.
Absolutely. And like, while we're talking about singles, like,
are you single? ladies.
No,
I'm gonna get drunk.
While we're talking about singles, I think like Ingrid Smith has really like, what's the word I'm looking for here?
I don't know what you're saying.
You're right, speaking of single.
Let me try again.
Hey, so, just swipe right or something on Twitter or Tinder. All right,
you know what? I'm gonna go. All right, no.
But like, you see him don't swipe left.
The Smiths put like such a stress on putting out like good singles, and not just like the song that is the A side, but like also the B side. Like, the Smiths B sides are some of the best.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Is that all the like. Actually, and we'll probably talk about it whenever we talk about the album.
How Soon As Now was a B-side.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, it was a B-side for William.
Yeah.
That was the B-side?
Well...
I mean, William, it was really nothing. It was great, but... no, you know, we're... That's great. How could that be the B-side?
William, it was really nothing.
Couldn't they have two A-sides? Has anybody ever tried that?
Here's the A-side. Oh, the other A-side.
There is no B-side. No. I have a Blur single that's A-side, and then you flip it over, and it's A-A-side.
A-A-side.
Yeah, no. But, like, William had... William, It Was Really Nothing as the A-side, and then the B-sides were Please, 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 and How Soon Is Now.
Yeah.
The thing is, okay, William, It Was Really Nothing... That's what I don't get. William, It Was Really Nothing is... It's maybe a 3-minute song. No, it's a great song.
Yeah.
But I'm saying, How Soon Is Now is 5 minutes. And Please, Please, Please is 2 minutes and 30-some seconds.
Yeah.
So why, I never got, why wouldn't you put two songs on one side? And two? You know, you got enough room.
Yeah.
But then again, I guess it's the size of a record anyway, so maybe you could just, anyway.
I don't know. It's just.
I think Morrissey was just obsessed with singles for some reason.
Yeah.
Because of how he grew up.
Yeah, the 60s girl pop singers.
Yeah, like, that's how people did it, is they put out singles, and I mean, it's just, that's just weird. I can't believe you'd put How Soon As Now on there. But then they did, I thought that they had, they... eventually released How Soon As Now as its own single.
Yeah, yeah, they did release that as their own single.
So it did end up being an A-side.
From what I understand, and again, I don't know if this is true, but from what I understand is because the B-side, How Soon As Now, got more play than William.
Yeah.
And so that's why they said, we better put out our own single for that.
Yeah.
But the problem was is that people didn't buy it because by then Half Full of Hollow had already released too, so they probably had William because that was a great single, and then Half Full of Hollow because that had so many things, and then when How Soon
came out,
why would you release a single like that had, I don't know,
it's more along the lines of the 7 inches, because back then the radio stations but I think radio stations had some kind of contractual obligation to different labels to only play A-sides and not the B-side. And so I think that was why. It's something weird back then.
Yeah, well, we'll leave it for the
The reason why you would do that, just from a business standpoint, is you want the radio station to play just the A-side.
Yeah.
And then people go out and buy it and find this awesome song on the B-side, and you're like, wow, this is really good.
Well, I know, but most of the time it's not an awesome song on the B-side.
Yeah.
That's
But, you know, a lot of times the B, like, you're like, we got this song, We don't have an album yet, but we got one good song, and we're going to put something on the other side. Yeah. So.
Well, and I don't understand that. B-sides shouldn't be songs that couldn't make the album cut. It should be awesome songs.
But they
that,
don't make the album
hidden
cut.
Treasures.
Yeah, they should. Yeah.
Because, well, I know, but I'm saying you don't want to buy the single, and it has a song that's on the song's going to be in the album, the first one. The second one, you don't want it to be on the album, because then it's like you're buying, like, and then you buy the album. I don't know. I don't know what I'm saying now.
Yeah, no.
Anyway. Like,
yeah.
I think it was That Joke Isn't Funny Anymore that had Well, I Wonder as the B-side, but both of them had already been released on Meat Is Murder, I think.
So but they, is that the one that has a live version of Meat Is Murder?
Oh, I can't remember for the life of me.
Well, anyway, what do we want to do? I was hoping that, you know, whenever we talk or whatever, is that we could go through each album and singles leading up to the albums, kind of like we're talking about.
Yeah.
But obviously, I need to do more research. You know, because I don't know the exact timeline on them.
Well,
but we can talk about, and maybe we can even like break up the album and, or say, oh, I wish this song would have been on here, or this song wouldn't have been on here. That would have been, you know, so go through each album and talk about the songs and stuff on them, the singles leading up to them, and say, oh, that would have been cool if they would have put this out, this song, you know, B-side or something on, like Handsome Devil.
Yeah.
Anyway, for the first album Gene.
You know, Gene isn't bad.
It's horrible.
You know what was good?
It's not bad. It reminds me of, like if I was trying to put, you know, like somebody gave me a cassette and said, hey, put lyrics to this, you know, because I'd totally go with the beat, you know.
Okay, so Gene isn't that bad of a song. What I liked was Wonderful Woman. That was one that should have been
okay.
More mainstream is Wonderful Woman.
Well, it would have fit on the first album, and that the Troy Tate thing happened.
Yeah.
I don't know, you know, and that's why I'm saying so we can all have some time to look into the first album and we don't even have to talk about forming the Smiths or whatever, but like the singles that led up to it, so we can all have more knowledge, you know, like, because I have the
Troy Tate,
and anyway, this is probably a cover from one that album or a CD that got warped or scratched up, and you know, so I put the original. Anyway, so this is the Troy Tate things, and I don't know if this is the exact, you know, order or whatever. I mean, not that it really matters, but...
Yeah, well, the thing is that when we look at some of this, we also have to look at speculate on what was going through their head. Like, at first... I wonder if Johnny Marr was thinking, you know, I have these really great things, and then Morrissey comes up with these really great lyrics. I wonder if by the time Strange Ways came around, Marr was saying, I'm coming up with all these great tunes, and Morrissey keeps doing the same damn thing over and over again.
Well, I mean, at least Johnny Marr was like, they're like doing like, what was that, Work Is a Four Letter Word and stuff, and he's like, these songs that I just...
Yeah.
Things suck, you know, like, so why,
from everything that I know, the recording of Strange Ways is actually, like, Johnny Marr's most enjoyable recording session, but when it came to do the B-sides, Johnny was just super tired, didn't want to do it. Morrissey kept egging the press, and Johnny just said, I'm done, I'm out.
Well, yeah, that's what it sounded like, but unfortunately he didn't explain that. He didn't explain why or anything. He just kind of left. At least it sounds, you know, from what he says and from what Morrissey says.
Okay, so talking about that real quick and talking about recording. The best story in this book, and we're not going to get into it here. We'll do it at a later time.
I think I know what the story is.
But it's when they were recording Queen Is Dead. And I think it was Queen Is Dead.
Yeah.
And they started having a dispute because they fired their manager, they got a new manager, and they started playing games with Rough Trade, and Rough Trade was playing games with them.
Oh, yeah.
So the funny story is how Johnny Marr tried to break in to get his own music.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wait, refresh my memory.
So basically, yeah, their manager said, hey, let's go to a bigger label. And Rough Trade said, no, you're under contract to us. And they had just kind of completed putting all the tracks down and putting everything down for Queen is Dead. And Rough Trade locked him up and said, you're not going to get anything, and we're not going to release this album because we're in a contract dispute now, because you're under contract with us, you can't leave.
Yeah.
And so Johnny was really pissed off about it and got drunk one night. Him and one of his friends, who was one of the roadie
probably
people, they drove up to the studio and broke into the house to
see. But they got him, right?
No.
What happens is Johnny and I can't remember who it was, but Johnny and
we'll call him
Mark.
Yeah. Larry. So Johnny and Mark, they break into the studio.
Larry Mark.
And Johnny grabs all the tapes and he has them all, like, in his hands.
Oh, he actually got them.
Yeah, and then somebody turns on the lights.
And it was the owner of the house that the studio's in.
He just asks Johnny what he's doing, and he's like, I'm going to steal the tapes. And he's like, are you sure? And Johnny's just like, nah. Puts them back.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so.
So we can get into it.
Yeah, because, I mean, that whole dispute, I think, delayed Queen's Dead, because they had already had it recorded like by 8 months or anyway. So I just want to talk and
about
the Smiths, and that's the whole idea of, and talk about whatever. So that's oh, by the way, if you don't know who the Smiths are,
if you don't know who the Smiths are, what the hell are you doing here?
If you don't know who the Smiths are, if you don't know who the Smiths are, in order of importance, Mike Joyce, Andy Rourke, Morrissey, Johnny Marr.
No.
Wait, in order, yeah, because Mike Joyce is the real muscle. You're saying in order of importance. I mean, he's worth at least, he ended up with 25%. So.
Yeah, no,
he's at least as equal.
I totally meant to make a joke like that, but it occurred to me I was going up, so
I was like, hey, man.
Yeah.
No, actually, that's one thing I want to talk about on the first album. So anyway, so I think
I think they can see it.
Oh, okay. But so the next time we'll talk about the first album.
Yeah.
If you've never listened to the Smiths,
again, what are you doing here? Go listen to the Smiths and
Yeah,
back.
Pause and
pause it right now.
But I'm saying I would recommend the first album as an introduction to people.
I don't know.
I would say like Hat Full of Hollow.
Yeah,
Hat Full of Hollow is definitely good. But if you're going to do anything from the first album, I'd say my two songs from the first album introduce.
Wait, we got to save that for the next podcast.
No. I'm saying if they don't know who the Smiths are. If they don't know who the Smiths are and they want to go to the first album, my recommendation for the first two songs to basically get into the Smiths are Suffer Little Children.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally.
Dude, this is explosive.
Yeah, Suffer Little Children.
Okay.
And then the other one would... You know, just for a more upbeat type of thing, I'd say This Charming Man.
Well, that's
not on the first album.
That's only in the US.
He's an imposter. No, This Charming Man's not even on the first album.
Only in the US.
I swear it's not.
On the US release, right?
Yeah, on the
well,
US release.
Well, now, see, okay, we're going to...
On the US release,
hey,
I think it's sandwiched in between.
Stay tuned for next episode. I think we've talked about
one way or another, we're going to sell.
Anyway, yeah. Okay, so remember that. Wait, paper, rock, scissors, whoever wins. Wait, you guys are against me.
Yeah.
Oh,
Go paper.
All right.
Okay, let's do it.
Wait, go paper?
Yeah, go.
Wait, so I only have a... Dang it.
Rock, papers.
Okay, you covered me. Yeah. Anyway, that's how it works. So, okay, This Charming Man was on. Wait, maybe...
No, see, now the thing is...
Oh, you know what? You're right. I was thinking that I think you are. Wait.
Yeah, this Charming Man was one of their first singles.
Yeah, actually, I was thinking of...
Because it was Hand in Glove.
I was thinking of a different...
Yeah.
But that's if you want something more upbeat and poppy.
What about Hand in Glove?
That's a great song.
No, I don't... it is a great song, but that version... Anyway, we're going to have to get into this next time. If anybody's even watching...
Who cares?
But who cares? That's what I'm saying.
I'll watch it.
But it's good to talk about it. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's good for us to talk about because... I mean, I don't know. I find it interesting. So anyway, we'll just stop there and whatever. Here we are.
Yeah.
We'll do it again soon. And maybe next time we'll actually have an album in front of us so we can...
Yeah. All right.
Maybe a full-size album. Do you have...
I got
rid of most of my stuff
So Mark knew me when I was a teenager, like 18, 19 years old. And I actually had every Smith single, import single, 12-inch single,
Hand in Glove, yeah.
Except for the 7-inch Hand in Glove. You had that.
I had that. I got it. One day I went into Stinkweeds. I had that. And like an idiot, I got rid of it.
Oh my God.
I know. And it had the little writing on the inside?
Yeah,
the penis is mightier than the sword or something.
No, I can't remember what the writing was for that one, but it was a blue label. I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it had the guy.
Which, by the way, if you are in the Arizona area, and more specifically the Phoenix area, still go to Stinkweeds. They're down in Phoenix now. They are the best, the best record store. When we went in there, the lady who owned it, her name was Kimber, and she knew her clientele by name.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not kidding you. She was so awesome. When we would walk in, when Mark and I would walk in, she would greet us by name. And she would even tell us, hey, I got the new, you know, whatever.
Well, yeah, I remember Gene?
Yeah.
Like, oh, I was like, oh, I'm looking for something. You know, I was always looking for the next Smiths. You know, but she's the one that told me about Gene. Oh, they kind of, you know, anyway.
Okay, funny story to end this.
Oh,
This also relates to,
we'll see.
It also relates
better,
to
we better laugh, man.
Okay, so Mark and I go record shopping, and back then, I was looking for tapes or records. I didn't really look for compact discs at that time. And so we go into Stinkweeds, and once we get in there, we kind of split up and we're looking at different things. And I come back, and Mark is holding a cassette tape in his mouth, and he's just kind of like chewing it and like
what?
Munching on it.
I don't think this is true.
And I said, what are you doing? And I kid you not, Mark said, I'm just checking to see if this is a good album to buy. And I'm like, what, you have to taste it? Well, it was the Blur album. It was their first album.
Leisure?
Blur's first album.
Oh, yeah.
And you were sitting there, you know, tasting the cover of it.
I remember I bought the Blur album, though. I hadn't heard anything by them. I just loved the artwork. It was the...
Yeah.
Because they had...
The
I mean, yeah, and this is back. They had the record... So it was nice and big. It was beautiful. The girl with the swimming cap on.
Yeah.
And they were, I mean, it was Blur.
It was a great thing. So Mark actually, that was a good system for
the taste test.
Yeah, so it tasted good to him. So we bought it. We listened to it on the way home and we were like, wow, this is really great.
Yeah, there's no other way. And
But yeah, Stinkweeds was an awesome place and Kimber definitely took care of all of us. In fact, when I had to sell all of my records, I sold it to Stinkweeds, and Kimber was actually really sad that I had to sell them, and she said she would hold on to them for me in case I wanted to buy them back for exactly what she paid for them.
Does she still have them?
No, when I came back, I...
You're like, hey, where are my records? You promised.
No, I walked in there, and she greeted me, and she knew me by name, and she's like, hey, you're back, and I said, yeah, and she said, I still have those records. Do you want to purchase them?
She still had them?
Yeah. She did not. She told me she would not.
Wait, was this when you went on a mission or whatever?
Yeah, just so you know, I'm LDS. And so I sold my records in order to go on a Mormon mission. And I sold my records to Kimber.
Are you LDS or Mormon? I'm confused.
Well, Mormon.
Same thing.
Mormon is a nickname. Anyway.
So anyway, when I came back from the mission... I went into State Queens and she recognized me and she greeted me and she said that she still had all my Smiths albums.
She still had that?
And she didn't sell them because I sold all my other stuff, but I didn't want to sell my Smiths stuff.
Yeah.
And she was very nice about it. And she, you know, I told her, you know, no, I'm not, I don't think I should purchase them back. And so she sold them. But it was the entire catalog for the Smiths, except for
Steve,
the 7-inch
hand
and glove. I had everything. Every single
And one. Now you've got nothing.
Yeah. Now I've got nothing.
So I feel cheated out most.
Yeah, he could have been, that was his inheritance.
No, you know why?
You sold his inheritance.
No, listen,
for what, a pot of stew?
No. I don't buy any physical media anymore.
No, that's...
And I don't do it because I don't want records or
well, CDs. I never liked records anymore.
I don't like the recording industry, the RIAA, because they say that if you buy like a CD or a record or a tape, you don't own that. It's still the artist or still the distribution company that owns it. And they can demand it back at any time. And I said, oh yeah, well screw you. I'll just buy digital at this point.
Wait, they can demand it back?
No, they can't. According to copyright law, you don't own the stuff on the disc, but you own that physical disc. They can never take that away from you. But the RIAA was making a big deal because that's when Napster was going big and the file sharing started happening. And so they tried to flex their muscle and they tried to say, oh yeah, well the recording companies actually own the physical media. And I said, well, if they own the physical media, there's no need for me to buy the physical media anymore. And so I never bought another physical disc after that. Fight the power.
All right, well, let's end this before we keep going.
Hold on. Do you know what you want to call this thing?
No. Do you have an idea?
Names?
This Charming Podcast. No.
Yeah, This Charming Podcast.
That's so lame.
I think
maybe if we want... Oh, go ahead.
I think we should name it We Love Stinkweeds and Hate the Recording Business.
There you go.
Well,
stinks.
We do like
stinks. Dude, let's call it Stinks. That's what my brother used to call it.
Let's call it
Stinks,
rank.
Man.
We'll call it Rank, and then we have both.
Rank?
Yeah.
What
stinks,
do you mean?
Rank.
Rank like the light on.
Oh, Stinks,
yeah.
Like it smells?
Yeah.
Rank cast.
Anyway, maybe if we watch it, somebody will say something.
So if we watch it, we will be hiding our faces in shame because we're like, holy crap, look how stupid we are.
I hate my voice.
Yeah.
Like whenever, I mean, I like it whenever I'm talking, you know, but whenever I hear it, it's like, I'm Kermit the Frog.
Okay, so we'll figure out something. If you're watching, leave a comment and we might choose that. So next time we might be called.
Shoot, if anybody comments, we'll call it that.
next time.
Welcome to an episode of You Guys Suck.
Yeah. two bald men, and a stupid kid.
Yeah. Ooh.
Neither of you are bald, though, I guess.
Oh, no. I am, look.
I just shaved.
That's bald.
Yeah.
Yeah, look at that head of hair. Can I run my fingers through it?
No.
Can you swim with it? Can you comb it like the hair club for men?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right,
so anyway.
So again, you are?
Mark.
You
Steven?
Are?
Steven.
Kaz. All right.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very
anyway,
much.
Anyway, it was fun talking about it.
Yeah,
and I can't wait to study up for the next. So the next one is the premiere Smiths album, debut.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. See you later, guys.
Bye. Kaz. Okay.
Shit.
Oh, yeah. All right.